And this session is a little bit tricky because it's about the Hacking SQL Server. My name is Michał Sadowski, and just a few words about me. I'm independent consultant, data platform expert. I just started something like 15 years ago as a system administrator. And this approach caused that I have a lot of experience related not only to purely SQL Server, but also to Windows Server. And both things plays hand in hand while we are discussing Hacking SQL Server. Also, I'm leader of Data Community Kraków chapter. As you can see, my interests are the high availability and disaster recovery. I was and I am still a big fan of certification, not just only to get the paper that I'm certified, but just to check yourself if you have all of the knowledge required just to administer the system, administer the SQL Server and other things. Please do not fall in the trap that I'm purely old style sysadmin guy, that I just want to have bare metal. I'm also interested in Azure. Recently, I passed two exams related to Azure, so I'm Azure administrator. My plan is just to extend it much more, just to take the best of both worlds, so on-premise and SQL Server, but on-premise and Azure, sorry. But of course, you need to know the basics. In case you know the basics, then the situation is much easier. Okay, the agenda for today is quite straightforward. The idea is that there will be a lot of demos. There will be short introduction, and then I will discuss something that is called SQL Server Browser. SQL Server Browser is available in SQL Server, I don't know since what version, but it's always with SQL Server. Then there will be a few words about the service accounts, why you should use or shouldn't use specific service accounts. And then a very common misconception about the local admin on the Windows level and sysadmin on SQL Server. And I will show how it's how it can be different that you can expect. Next point related to database owner. Usually it's being overseen that we have the database owner, we are restoring the database, and usually in case we are not specifying it as execute as specific user, then it will be the context of the user that is restoring the database, so automatically this user will be DB owner. And the last one, the case about forgotten password for service account. However, it's not only about the forgotten password, it's about the whole approach that you should have in mind when you deploy SQL Server. There will be one slide with all of the tools that I have used, but of course all of the tools are available, publicly available on the internet, so it's just adding all of the puzzles together just too big to have a bigger picture. And of course, at the end, there will be a short summary. In case that are any questions, just please ask, because this presentation is demo-based, so you know the gods of demos. I hope that they will help me today, that nothing will break. Of course, I have strong support in the front, so hopefully everything work fine. Okay, at the beginning, nice picture. And this picture is some kind of the analogy of SQL Server. For me, it was from very beginning when I started with SQL Server. I thought that, okay, we have the SQL Server, and the SQL Server is something like this fortress on the island that no one has access to that, and it's secure by design. So from that perspective, I was living in that belief for many years. And after some time, I just discovered that as it is on this picture, when you have a deeper look, you will see that there are some windows opened, there are some gates, there are some specific paths. You can take a boat and then just travel to this island. So from the 10,000 feet approach, everything is secure. However, again, the implementation is extremely, extremely critical. But the case is with all of the other systems. I just want to show the methodology that there is something called secure software. Secure software is only when you apply some additional steps, when you address all of the potential risks that can encounter on the system. So let's move on to this picture. Do you recall what's that? It's called Duga. It's located in Ukraine, and it's the Over Horizon radar. And this radar works in the way that there are two radars located in high distance, and it was designed in the 80s. So when the approach was that it was built on the in Russia, and the idea of that was that when Americans start the missile from the United States, this radar will be able to see it over the horizon. So this one was located in close to Chernobyl, and the power plant located in Chernobyl was giving the power just to have it up and running. In case any of one is interested in that, you can search for Russian woodpecker. It's the call that the term that was causing a lot of issues for all of the persons using the common band radios, that the all of the frequencies were polluted by this special frequency. Just to give you some kind of the rough estimation how big it is 300 meters wide and 150 meters high. So it's extremely big building. And in Russia there were, this one is located currently in Ukraine, but in Russia there were two sets of them, one on the west side of the Russia and the other one on the east side, so close to Sakhalin. But okay, you can ask why I'm discussing this on SQL Server conference. Do you have any, can you see any connections to SQL Server? No, it's not right to think that the next session will be on Ukraine. It's related to this configuration settings, that when you install SQL Server, you have SQL Server browser. And as you probably know, SQL Server browser is the service that is translating the instance name into the port. So it is actively spreading the information on the network about the all of the installed instances of SQL Server. But you can ask, okay, you are just claiming so there is no proof that it's working in that way. So it is the idea that I will just show you a demo how it works and why you should consider if it should be enabled or it should be disabled by default. Okay, so let's switch to demo. Let me switch. I have few machines. Just for your information, the most interesting one are the domain controller, because I just use the credentials. I have SQL Server and I have Windows. So I have two machines. One is the SQL Server and the other one is Windows. And then I will try to connect from one service to the another. So let's switch to the one of the machines. I'm on the Windows, so I'm trying to connect to the Windows, to the SQL Server. I'm just showing that SQL Server is up and running. So as you will see, I was able to connect. But what's going on in the background? There is exchange of the information, and those exchange of the information can be captured. We can use some kind of the Windows tools, but I will show it on the Linux tools just to show you that it's not related to any specific version. It's just all of the traffic sent through the network. I have here instance of the Kali Linux. It's available software that can be download from internet. Hopefully it will work. Okay, and here I will just start Metasploit. So let me start Metasploit software. Have you ever heard about such tools?
Yes.
Have you used it?
Yes.
Very good. In this Metasploit, it is the set of the tools that can be used just to check your system, to check if your system is secure. I'm looking for something that is called SQL ping. So I'm just typing search MSSQL_ping. And hopefully something will be found here. Hopefully you can see the screen. I can try to make it a bit bigger. So I'm just configuring to use this specific module. And then just to see the options. So show options. So we have the situation that in one network, we have the Linux and we have SQL Server, we have Windows, and then we are trying to discover all of the SQL servers that are located in that network. So I'm just setting the air hosts to my subnet. My subnet is 10, 20, 31 till, let's say, 50, because I know that there is not much more than IP address of 50. And then I'm changing the threads to like 50, and then just to run. And now, as you can see, this tool is the third-party tool. It's in not any way related to Windows Server nor to SQL Server. You can see that it discovered that there is Microsoft SQL Server, so the instance name is MSSQL, so it means this is the default instance. Is clustered is no, version is 15.0.11.0.0.94. What that information gives us? Exactly, it's the path that we should proceed, that we can see exact version, exact build of the SQL Server. Very often I have seen in many implementations that when you install SQL Server, you just install the SQL Server and first or available service pack. In case it was like 5 years ago, then there was no service pack. Until now, no one is interested in installing any security updates, any cumulative updates or service pack on SQL Server. And there are many vulnerabilities on this system. So from that perspective, you are putting yourself into risk. Okay, but you can ask how it will be mapped to the risk that I can lose something or so. I have the second demo. The second demo is, or maybe the second part of this demo, is related to the hijacking the password. When you are using the SQL login, then you are providing the login and then you are providing the password. Do you think if this approach is secure? If any one of you is using it on the production system, usually you are using because there are some third-party software that are not able to use the Windows credentials. And then unfortunately, there is a huge risk that it will leak outside of the application. The idea of that demo is that I'm preparing something that is called ARP spoofing. It means that I'm just saying that I am the different server. So this Linux server will be saying to the SQL server that it is the Windows client, and to the Windows client it will be saying that I'm the SQL server. So all of the traffic will be going through this device. So I'm just starting ARP spoofing on the both of the on the one interface, but in both directions. There is some additional configuration required that I will be just mirroring all of the packets that are going through the specific interface into this machine, so we will be able to see how it's working. And again, I'm using this Metasploit. It's not the Metasploit, but it's MSF console. So I'm running this Metasploit, and then inside the Metasploit, I will try to catch all of the packets that are being sent. So I'm just looking for something that is called capture MSSQL. I should find the module. There is a lot of them, so it's the capture wrong slash. I have the module that is available to be used. I have the module already loaded, and then just show two options. What are the options? By default, in case we know that SQL Server is listening on the default port, so on 1433, we do not need to do anything. We just need to run it. And then, as you can see, it is running in the background, and it is actively poisoning the cache of both servers. So the client server thinks that it's connecting to SQL Server, however, is routed through this Linux server. I will switch back to the to client machine, and from Management Studio, I will try to use the SQL login, showing the login name and the password. Okay, so as you can see here, maybe I will just run zoom it just to have it more. I'm just trying to disconnect from the server and trying reconnect again. The only difference is that I'm using the here SQL Server. Oh, it's not working. I'm running here SQL Server authentication. So instead of using Windows authentication, I'm using the second option and providing SQL Server authentication. I have some kind of the application, usually application account, and this account is used for the accessing the database. I'm clicking connect, and then you can say wrong password. But when we switch back to the Linux, you will see that there is something here that can be a bit interesting. Let me scroll down. You can see MS login. Here is the my account name, and here you can see the password that I have typed in. So every time when you are trying to use the SQL login instead of Windows authentication, just please have in mind that it's like showing the password to everyone located in the same network. Any questions to that? Okay. Very good question, because the whole idea of this session is not to show how to break, but the idea is how to show how to fix the those issues. There are at least two options. First option is just to use certificates, so SSL TLS. You should use TLS, but TLS certificates. When we are using TLS certificates, all of the traffic is being encrypted by that. So it is the first solution. And the other one is just to use Windows built-in options to that is provided by PKI, that you can encrypt the traffic between SQL Server. And of course, you should have the separate network, like VNet, virtual network, just only for the communication between the SQL Server and the application server. Is it answering your question? You need to have the whole PKI public infrastructure. Once you have the public infrastructure, then you can rotate the key. So the application needs to handle a certificate correctly. And then in case the application is able to use the certificates, then you can enforce on the SQL Server that the certificate. Yeah, it is. So how to change it? You can just check it on the I just need to switch to the other machine, and inside the configuration manager, you can configure it on the protocol. So it's the SQL Server configuration manager, and here you have the option for the certificate. You need to generate the proper certificate. There are the guidelines on the internet how you can prepare the certificates, and then this certificate will be visible here. By default, there is no certificate at all, and by default, the connection is not encrypted. So everything is being sent unencrypted through the network. Yes? In case you have the PKI infrastructure already in place, then it should be done automatically, because all of the machines inside the domain, they should request automatically the certificates. But I guess your question is pointing to key certificate rotation. So when the certificate is expired, then you need to replace it. And for that, you need to stop the sequence server engine, and you need to replace the certificates also on the clients. So for that, you need to have the maintenance window.
Excuse me, I have, does it affect performance?
Encrypting of the connection, because you need to spend some additional CPU cycles just on encrypting. But I would say it's negligible because you are just gaining security, but you are losing some of the performance. The main question here is what you would like to protect from. In case it is the attack, then I would say that you can pay this extra load on CPU just to have it secured. Okay, let's move on to the next thing. The next thing that it's just recall me a very common situation that you are working in, let's say, big corporation, and then you have third-party application, and this third-party application requires specific user, and this specific user needs to be a member of one of the server role, and the server role is called sysadmin. And when you have that, it's like by default. And also, when you perform one of the mistakes during the configuration, when you use SQL, during the configuration, you will provide local administrator account. In case you will provide local administrator account, then there is a huge risk of losing the machine. So someone can break into your machine. So let's try to do it. The approach is as follows. First, I just need to turn off the Metasploit because I will be not able to connect to the machine. Okay, it's stopping, so it should be working now. I'm just switching back to the machine, so I'm connected to the client, and this client is trying to connect to the SQL server. It's done. Okay, so how many of you have heard about something called XPCMD shell? Okay, and what is being used for? Exactly, so we are just trying to access the operating system, to be exact, file system of the operating system with some specific permissions. So first thing is how to configure. You need to use spconfigure. Just to check if the option is available. It's on the very bottom, the last option. XPCMD shell, in my case, it is run value is set to 1. So in my case, XPCMD shell is configured to be run. So let's try to XPCMD shell and just check who am I. We can see that we are running just in the context of the SQL server. It's by design because we have the service account is only for the SQL server. And the next step is just to leverage that XPCMD shell functionality. We have something that is called net commands. The net commands are available from, I don't know, Windows 2000 or even NT. So I'm just running XPCMD shell with the option net local group. And I will try to execute just to see what options do we have. You can see that we have this specific group. It's called the administrators. So first I can just check if there are some members of the local group administrators. As you will see, there is one account, and this specific account is MySQL Server account. So MySQL Server is running on the local administrator. How we can leverage this situation to gain the access to the machine? I would say that maybe not the half, but part of the answer is already on the screen. So we have the net command and net. Not. We are just using another approach. Net user add. So we are trying to add the user. And this user, how should I call it? What? WinAdmin. I have the already WinAdmin. I was just, I would say my admin, and then with some specific password. The command completed successfully. What does it mean? We have a new user. Is this user already member of local administrators group? So how we can do it? How we can add? xpcmd shell net local group administrators my admin app, and let's check if it's going to work. Okay, so we have new user. This new user is called my admin, and then we should be able to log on to the machine. What do you think? I'm able to log on or not? We need to check it.
I don't think local administrator groups have by default.
They have. It's not the case about the database, it will be the next point, but. The only thing that you need to configure is that by default, as I'm using now, I'm just remotely connecting to the server. So I just need to do it before. I just need to configure the server in that way that I'm able to log on remotely. And now I have just added additional user, and using this additional user, I will try to connect to this machine. But it's not the machine, the client, but it's the machine of SQL Server. By default, no one should have access to SQL Server because it's too, the license for SQL Server is too expensive just to allow the end users playing on the SQL Server. So let's try to connect to this SQL Server. I will just run an additional connection. My server is 27, so it's the IP address. And now I'm just providing the new account, so my admin with my specific password. Okay, I was able to log on. The profile is being created. I'm the local administrator of the machine. Does it mean that I have the access to the SQL Server? Correct. We do not have access to SQL Server. So the next question: is it possible to gain access to SQL Server?
Yes.
Exactly. It's the correct answer. In case you are using SQL Server 2005 or earlier, you shouldn't, because extended support for 2008 is going to expire in June this year. But there are some specific situation in some of the companies that we need to have, for example, SQL Server 2005. And in SQL Server 2005, by default, there was a group on SQL Server, there was a group built-in administrators. And everyone from the local administrator on the Windows level, they have automatically sysadmin access to the SQL Server. Okay, we have here the newer version of SQL Server. It's 2019 CTP 2.1, and I just use the CTP version just to show that even the latest and greatest version of the SQL Server not available yet is still vulnerable for this same approach. So how we can gain the access to SQL Server?
Running single mode.
Is the first option running single user mode? I will show it within next few minutes, but there is much easier option to have it. Have you ever heard about the sysinternals tools? Mark Rusinovich, does it ring the bell? This guy wrote the tool that is called PSExec. And within PSExec, you have the magic switch, as I'm calling it. It's minus S that is calling that your session, when you are administrator on the machine, your session, your this command window or the program will be executed with the rights of the local system. And if you never have ever heard about the local system, in Windows you have the normal users, you have the administrators, and then you have local system. Local system is something that is higher than administrator. In case you have any issues with some of the processes that you cannot access, that you get the access is denied, that you cannot stop this process, using local system is much easier. So from that perspective, it's the goal just to show how it can be executed. Hopefully I have it on my server. I should have it in tools directory. I have the PS tools, so it's the when you type into Google, Bing, whatever sysinternal suits, you will have the set of the tools. I'm starting the command line. Maybe I'll just change the font just to be able to see it a little bit more clearly. And colors, not this one. This one, hopefully it will be better. And I'm just switching to this directory, and there is PSExec minus I minus S. Minus I is saying that it will be executed as interactive. And the other one is local system. Is it going to work now when I just add CMD? It won't, because you need to pay the attention to details. You need to be local. You need to run the command window as the administrator. So I will just restart it as a as administrator. Okay, again. This time should be faster. So changing to the PS tools, and now PSExec minus ES CMD. Agree. And as you can see, when I type who am I, I'm anti-authority system. Again, changing the fonts. I'm the anti-authority system. What does it mean that I'm anti-authority system? How I can leverage that situation to get access to SQL Server? We can just start Management Studio. Just copy the link to Management Studio, and then you will be starting Management Studio in the context of the other in the context of the other user. In this case, anti-authority system. So just to save time, I'm not going to show it. You know how to do it. Just to copy the link to Management Studio, and then you are able to access SQL Server. Someone mentioned about the single user mode. In case we, when we have the SQL Server, we need to stop our service. So I will just use it here. So net stop MS SQL. The service is stopping, and now I just need to have the path to the executable. I will just bypass it quite quickly, just to have it, just to save some time. Binaries. It should be SQL. SRV-exe, and the key point here is that you need to have the flag minus M. I will just change the properties just to see the just to see that it's here, it's minus M. When you start it minus M, even though that you are the you are local administrator, however you're not sysadmin, you can still have the access to SQL Server. How you can gain this access? So I'm just starting it here. And how you can access that? Just running SQL CMD. SQL CMD and pointing to the specific SQL server. Any questions to that? It has.
It
has? In case there is a knowledge base article on internet, you can remove this anti-authority system. However, Microsoft is advising to leave this account enabled. So on production system, there is possible risk of issues with the support when you remove that. So you are right, we can protect from that in that way. So any other ideas regarding getting the access to the SQL server? Have you ever heard about something that is called volume shadow services? It's the tool used by the usually it's using is being used by the third party tools for the backups. So the idea is that SQL server is being, let's say, silenced. So it's like freezed for some specific of time, and then this backup software is able to take the consistent snapshot of the system. However, the issue here is that it's using it's starting from the Windows perspective, and it's connecting using the specific account. When you have a look at the services, so I will just run services. You will see that. Below SQL Server, you have something that is called SQL Server Writer, and this account also has the sysadmin role on the system. The way to leverage access by this is just to edit the registry entries, because all of the services that are in registry, and just to change the path to this executable to the SQL code. So we are just changing it to adding the new user and then adding this user to the specific sysadmin role. And then what you need to do is just to try to start the service. The service will fail, but your account will be added to this group and then you have the access. So what is the learning from this exercise? First thing, never ever give access to your SQL Server. SQL Server is only for the DBAs, and DBAs also shouldn't connect there. I mean, the DBAs should have access to that server, but this server, you shouldn't work remotely on the database engine. And the second learning is the learning from the local administrator rights. Have you heard about something like called the managed service account? It was introduced in Windows Server 2008, and then it was introduced something called Group Managed Service Account, and this Group Managed Service Account protects you from that attack, because within Managed Service Account, you cannot start anything interactively. In case you cannot, then you cannot perform this attack. Okay, let's move on to the next thing. The next thing is about the database owner. With database owner is the like with these doors and the keys. You can have the best in class protecting devices. You can have all of the encryption. You can have everything that makes you feel that you are protected. But in case you will take off this key and give this key to some random person, then you are losing everything that you have built before. And the same situation is with the DB owner. You can say that, okay, but DB owner is nothing important. We have the sysadmins, and within the sysadmins, we can perform all of the tasks. DB owner shouldn't be possible to done it. I will just show you few examples what DB owner can do on your database. So let's switch to the client again. The client is located here, and I will just open the other management studio. I'm just connected using account that is called DB owner. As you can see here, it's the DB owner. and I have access to the my database. My database is called AdventureWorks 2017. However, I do not have access to the other things on the server. I will just see my account, nothing more. So when I check the properties of my account, I even cannot, oh, sorry, it's the single. Let's switch back to the demo and then just to stop the, maybe just close it and then start SQL Server again. Once SQL Server is up and running, when I will try to see in within what server roles my my account is, I can see that I'm just public, and the only mapping is for the AdventureWorks AdventureWorks database. And within AdventureWorks, I'm the DB owner, so I have all of the rights within that. That database. So let's start with guessing what can we do within that. I just switched to the master database. First thing, we can turn on auto shrink. Do you think it's affecting the performance? It can severely affect the performance. So let's try to do it. Completed successfully without issues. Next thing is about the auto update statistics. We can just turn it off because on test system is just running faster without the auto update statistics. Can we do it? Yes, of course. Next thing, we can switch the recovery model. So we have at the moment we have simple, we can change it to full. In that way it's not affecting. In the worst case, from my experience, it will just fill up all of the disk space. But imagine the opposite situation. You have the production system, and then on production system you have full recovery model, and someone will just switch recovery model from full to simple. And then there will be disaster, and then you have your procedures in place. You just take the last full backup, you take all of the transaction log backups, and then it turns out that you do not have transaction log backups because you have your database in simple recovery model. What's more, we can perform the backup. So we are not sysadmins, and we can perform the backup of the database. The same story, performing backup without copy-only option will affect the whole chain of the backups, so you need to be really careful about that. And the last thing is about the certificates. The scripts will be available, but the main idea here is that you have the production system. On production, you are using certificates. Those certificates are used for the generating of the symmetric keys. And using the symmetric keys, you are just encrypting data in the database because you would like to be compliant with some of the regulations. And someone with DB owner can just remove those keys. When the keys are lost, then unfortunately, you have small issue because you have the data, however, you cannot access that data. So it's you can just remove everything from the database. And the last example is related to the setting database offline. So developer or the person that has the DB owner rights can just take the database offline. And the question is, in case I'm able to take it offline, is it possible to take it online? What do you think? It depends. So let's check it. It looks like you can. So it's interesting that even though that the database is on in offline mode, still you can take it. Still you can take it online. And the last thing, what do you think? Can I drop my database being the database owner? From my perspective, for many years, I was expecting that no, because sysadmin should be able to do it, not DB owner. But when we check it, we see that yes, we can just drop the database. So the conclusions from that is quite straightforward. Never ever give the DB owner. In case you have the DB owner, you can use built-in functionality of SQL Server. It's called policy-based management. in conjunction with central management server, and then you can check which databases are with the owner different than SA or other account that is the system administrator role. So you need to leverage that that built-in functionalities just to have it safe. We have time for the last demo, and the last demo is about the forgotten service account password. Probably when you are working as a database administrator, you know all of the best practices. You are providing the specific accounts only for SQL Server. When you have the account for the SQL Server, officially you should rotate the password of that service account. But from my experience, it's extremely challenging, because when you are just need to do it, then you need to synchronize it. So we need to request the change of the password. Then you need to stop all of the services. In case you have clusters, then the situation starts to be more and more challenging. So usually everyone just forgets about that. First about the changing the passwords. And imagine the situation when there is a system that is like 5 years old. It was built by external consultant. External consultant just installed it, requested some password, and everyone just forgotten about the passwords. Do you think if it is possible to extract in some way the password that is being used by specific service, not only SQL Server?
Yes.
There are some possibilities. And here is my question. How many of you are using Windows Server 2019? Okay, 2016? A little bit more? 2012? I would say two-thirds of is using something that is below, for sure, 2019. Why am I asking about that? Because Microsoft is making huge effort to provide secure environment, and there are some changes within the kernel of the system. And by default, it is possible to, by default in 2019, it is not possible to extract that password. So all of the tools that I will show within a minute is you cannot run it because the vulnerability was fixed. But the conclusions is that you should always use the latest possible version of operating system, because by default it gives you many enhancements, and those enhancements usually are not visible. For us, whatever it is, 2012, 2016 or 2019, it's still operating system. It's not our field, it's just something that is given. But in case you will request new server, just think about the latest version, because there is huge probability of fixing all of the issues that are available in previous operating system. Okay, so let's switch to the demo, and the demo is as follows. I will just connect to the SQL Server engine, and then I will try to use something that is called some fancy tool. This tool is available on internet, is available on GitHub even, but please do not try to download it on a corporate network, because in case you don't know the security guys, then just type into the internet Mimikatz, and then you will know the security guys, because usually within, it depends on the corporation, but I guess within minutes you will be just the first person that is trying to do something wrong with the operating system. And for that, I just prepared the machine in the way that it's not complaining about this tool. This tool is called Mimikatz, and I will just show this this tool. And it's some kind of the small executable that you can just run on the system. So I'll just run the command window, and within the command window, I will try to run this. Application. Let's correct the layout. And I will just move to the D drive. On D, I have tools, and then should be Mimikatz version x64. And then I will just run the Mimikatz. As you can see, it's the command line application that you can just have the some fun with the some of the accounts. Maybe from the different perspective. In case you are installing SQL Server, there are three rights that you need to have on your account. For sure, you need to be local administrator, but there is a very special right that you need to have it. It's the debug privilege. Without debug privilege, it's not possible to install SQL Server. And from my experience, many of the corporations, they are protecting from this type of the attacks, that they are just prohibiting or revoking the debug permissions from the, all of the local administrator accounts. In case you don't have this permissions, then this attack won't work. And it's still, again, the point about the latest version and latest security best practices. Here I have possibility of granting this permission. So it is privilege debug. I got OK. When I have OK, then I can just run secure LSA logon passwords. As you can see, there are all of the huge list of the credentials available on my machine. I will just try to scroll up to the very beginning, because from my experience, usually it's on the very beginning. And here you will see all of the tokens that are available on the system. So you have the logon time, logon server, and when you scroll a little bit down, then you will see my account. SQL Server is running under the SQL Server account, and the password is secret password for engine. And using this tool, you can just extract it just like that. But just be really careful running it on the corporate machines, because all of the antiviruses, this machine is specially crafted. It's the latest version of the Windows Server. However, for that, I just need to disable the Windows Defender, and I need to change one registry keys. But you can easily imagine that it can be done by some kind of the third-party malware software that you download from the internet. And here is again the point, never ever use interactively SQL Server. Because I know that on SQL Server, the internet is the fastest in the company, but still you are taking the resources and you are putting the high risk on SQL Server with getting something, some malware from the from internet. Any questions to this example? Okay, so what counteractions we can have regarding those attacks? First, the least privilege principle. So just grant the lowest possible privilege to all of the SQL Server accounts, just the bare minimum that is required just to run the SQL Server. Always use managed service account. It was designed just to protect you from that type of the attack. In case you have cluster, when you have the always on, you can always use group managed service account. And when it is available, why not to use it? The advantage of managed service account is that you do not know the password. You do not need to provide this password. And the password is automatically rotated by the domain controller. Remember that local admin is sysadmin. So never rely on the false impression that, okay, we have one group of the local admins and we have the other group of sysadmins. Local admin can have access to SQL Server also. Configuration, not the default one. You need to know what are the risks. You need to know how to countermeasure those risks. Search on internet for something that is called hardening. There are some documents from Department of Defense of United States about the SQL Server, how you can protect it, how you can disable unnecessary services. Of course, when you reconfigure or disable some of the services, check if it is running with your application, because application can be different. There are some built-in functionalities like policy-based management. How many of you have used policy-based management? Not many, I guess 2-3 persons. Central management server, just for the administering more than few servers. Okay, policy-based management and central management server, just look for it. It is available in the products starting from, as far as I remember, 2008. Logon trigger. Very simple, but very powerful. Just to allow logging to the SQL server from very specific IP addresses, and then it will protect you from, maybe not protect, but it will increase the barrier, entry barrier to the SQL server. Auditing, from time to time, check if the SQL server is behaving in the correct way, check the logs, add some extended event session just to see if SQL Server is operating as you would like to have it. And remember, the chain is as strong as the weakest link. So in case you have something like that here, it's not going to be extremely secure. So even though that you have the latest and the greatest hardware, you have security chips, you have hardware encryption, and so on and so on, still, in case you will leave the doors open, then everyone can access your SQL Server. About the resources, there are many resources available on the internet. The presentation will be available. The first link is to the SQL Player blog, where there's my article about the preparing for the installation of the SQL Server. And there are described step by step how you can just use the managed service account in the Active Directory domain. In case you are interested in protecting by SSL TLS, there is knowledge base article on Microsoft website. There are some blogs that can help you with that. And the Mimikatz is available on GitHub, and Kali Linux is available on internet. So you can download the ISO of Kali and then just try to play with your SQL Server. There is a question? Yeah, it's the bigger topic, SSL. I'm just used here SSL as the acronym of the green padlock in the internet. TLS, you shouldn't use SSL because SSL is vulnerable from many different angle of attacks. You should use TLS in the latest version, at least version 1.2. So here is just only to let you know this about the SSL. However, here it is described that how to configure Windows Server to use only TLS so that you will be secured. And from my side, I would say that is all. So it's the tools that have been shown. Are there any questions? No questions, so thanks a lot for attending the session. In case you have any other questions, I will be available here for the next few minutes and also some around the conference. Thank you, and enjoy the rest of the conference.